introduce Kaisa Matameki, who will speak to us this afternoon.
This morning, rather.
Thank you.
Thanks for the introduction, and thanks to the organizers for inviting me to speak here. So I will talk about Vinogradov's 3 primes theorem for some special sets of summons. And the things I'm going to talk about are joined with Enando Xuanzheng Zhao, and some of the things are also joined with James Maynard. So let's start with Vinogradov and state Vinogradov's 3 primes theorem that I'm going to talk about. So it's the Vinogradov, 1937. And what he saw that was that if we take any large enough integer, which is odd, then it's a sum of 3 primes. They exist 3 prime numbers p1, p2, p3. So I use the letter p for the set of primes, such that n is the sum of these 3 primes. So earlier, Goldbach had conjectured that every large number, I mean larger than 5 odd number, is a sum of 3 primes, and all the even numbers are sum of 2 primes. And then Vinogradov managed to solve this ternary case that every large enough odd number is a sum of 3 primes. And more recently, Helfgott has shown that actually you can take n naught to be 7. So the optimal value, I mean, 7 is 2 plus 2 plus 3, and from that up, every odd number is a sum of 3 primes. So for Vinogradov, this was just some unfixed, some large constant that wasn't computable. And after that, there are some people who gave a computable constant there, but this is sort of the correct, I thought, by Helfgott a few years back. Okay. But I will take a bit more additive combinatorial notation for these things, just to make things easier to state. So let me introduce this notation first. So we write a plus b for the sum set. So that's just the set of all sums, a plus b. The a is in set A, and b is in set B. And then we can state Vinogradov's theorem in different terms. It's that b plus b plus b contains all large enough odd integers. So this is Vinogradov's theorem in sort of additive combinatorial notation. This is the sum of all ways you can, all things you can write as a sum of 3 primes, and it says that all large enough odd numbers are sum of 3 primes. And the question I want to focus today is what happens if we take a subset of the primes rather than all of primes. So the question is, what about if we have a subset of primes? What happens if we look at p plus p plus p? Do we still have that? For some subset of the primes, do we still have that all odd large integers are representable as a sum of the 3 primes? And this, of course, depends on what this set P is, but I want to give some results in this shape that say that if we take a subset of the primes, which are this chosen such and such way, then we can represent all large odd integers as a sum of 3 primes. So this is sort of a strengthening of Vinogradov's theorem, because the binary Goldbach seems to be very difficult. There is no way we can show that all large even integers are sum of 2 primes. So we want to somehow give a stronger version of Vinogradov's 3 primes theorem without actually hitting the difficult looking binary problem. Anyway, let's first just look at what happens if we had just some general subset of the primes. And for this, we have a theorem due to Enando in 2014, which says that if set P has lower density at least larger than 5/8 in prime, so I mean a relative global density, so that the proportion 5/8 of the primes belong to the set P. Then we have this Winogradov three prime theorem. That every large enough odd integer is representable as a sum of three primes from this set P. So notice that here we don't request anything about the set P. It can be anything that has density at least 5/8. So this is only asking something about the density, and then we already know that Winogradov's result holds. So in particular, if P is the set of all primes, then this recovers Winogradov's theorem, but the proof uses somehow the Winogradov's theorem. But anyway, and what we can notice about this thing is that this is actually a sharp result. So we can cook up a set of density 5/8 for which Winogradov's three primes theorem doesn't hold. So we can take the set of primes to be those that belong to certain congruence classes. So they are 1, 2, 4, 7, or 13 modulo 15. And this set has the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different residue classes, and the number of co-prime residue classes mod 15 is 8. So this set has density 5/8 by the prime number theorem in arithmetic progressions. But if n is 14 modulo 15, then you can check that you can't represent 14 as a sum of three of these residues here, which means that anything which is congruent to 14 mod 15 is not in the subset. So this is the sort of notation for P plus P plus P. Anyway, so in this sense, the Fernandez result is sharp, and we have to start posing some more conditions to our set P if we want to say something about sets of smaller density. And the first natural question is that here we have a sort of congruence obstruction. We are our set of primes lies in just certain residue classes, modulo something rather small. So one can ask is if this is the only possible obstruction for the ternary Goldbach to hold. So what happens if we don't have any such congruence obstructions, if all the residue classes modulo all small things have a sort of fair proportion of primes? So the first question is, what if no congruence obstruction? So do we then have, if we have a subset of the primes for which all reasonable residue classes have some primes, do we then have Winogradov's three primes theorem? But the answer is actually not. I should first say that this is not quite obvious what this means, but let's just pretend that it means that we take all the residue classes up to some large Q, say log X, and look A mod Q for each Q at most log X, and say that all of these contain a proportion epsilon of primes or something like this. But anyway, the question is, what if there are no congruence obstructions? Is there any other kind of obstruction that prevents us from having the ternary Goldbach holding? And actually there is another example. So if we take our subset of the primes, the set of those primes for which say square root 2 times p, distance from the nearest integer, is at most 1 over 6 minus epsilon. So here this is distance of so get something at most half, because whatever your number you take, it's distance from the nearest integer is at most half. And what if we look at the set of primes for this, which this distance is at most 1 over 6 minus epsilon? Then if we look at the set of 3p, then we sum 3 of these things, then the distance from the nearest integer is at most 3 times this. So this is contained in the subset of integers for which the distance of square root of 2 times n is at most half minus 3 epsilon. And then what is noteworthy here is that this set of primes is equidistributed in arithmetic progressions to small moduli, because this square root of 2 is irrational. Essentially, because of this, this is nicely distributed in arithmetic progressions, so there are no congruence obstructions for this. But also this thing here is equidistributed in the interval from 0 to half, and that means that there are some odd integers for which this doesn't hold. Actually, there's a proportion like 6 epsilon of those integers for which this doesn't hold. So for this set P, the ternary Goldbach fails. So not all. So here we find another sort of example. Here we had the congruence obstruction, but here there are no congruence obstructions, but there is a so-called Borset obstruction that we have some obstructions modulo 1 for this multiple. And of course, you could replace square root of 2 here by any rational number. And 1 over 6 you could replace by anything smaller, and you would be in problems. And also you can consider more general Borsets where you have sort of intersections of different things like this. And in particular, in general, we have trouble if P concentrates on the Borset. And by a Borset, I mean a generalization of this sort of notion. So we write that it is a set of primes for which we have these sort of conditions for several frequencies, square root 2. So something like alpha I p plus beta, distance from the nearest integer, is at most eta. So this here is the case k equals to 1, alpha 1 equals to square root of 2, and beta equals to 0, and eta equals to 1 over 6 minus epsilon, but it's sort of believable that this sort of obstruction extends to different things like this. So this is the troublesome case that we have a set which concentrates on the Borset. And then the next question is, what if there are no Borset obstructions? What happens then? Is this then really the only kind of obstruction we might have? And the answer for that is positive. So this is, if you speak just qualitatively, this is the only possible obstruction. So note in particular that this congruence obstruction sort of is included in a Borset obstruction if you take a rational alpha I, but let's not care about that really too much. So the first theorem I'm stating is there to myself and Fernando, which says essentially that this is the only sort of obstruction that we might have. So for simplicity, let's look at subset of primes that have positive lower density. So let's look at the subset of the primes which has a positive lower density delta. And then the claim is that if for all ball sets B with An 1 over eta bounded, one has that if you look at the number of primes inside this ball set, then this is at least, say, delta to 100 times the expected number of primes. Except that we have to be a bit careful here because of these possible congruence obstructions, and in particular because, say, the congruence class 0 mod 5 doesn't contain any primes, and you can cook up the Bohr set which just contains integers that are 0 mod 5, and then if we just have condition like this, it would fail for the Bohr set picking up 0 mod 5, so we have to be a bit careful about congruence classes because of this. Here the right-hand side does contain things, and Bohr set is in 0 mod 5 because it just counts all the integers, so we have to do some sort of W trick, which has been used by Ben Green and Derrida, for instance, on the things. So what we have to do is we look instead primes modulo A modus W for some A and compare them with the number of integers A mod W. And now we get another correction factor from this, having this congruence condition here. But you can ignore this W aspect here. Go prime to W. But the point really is that if we have that all the Bohr sets which have bounded parameters, so there is only a bounded number of these inequalities, and we have some epsilon which is bounded from below, or eta which is bounded from below for this Bohr set parameter. So if all these Bohr sets contain a fair proportion of primes from our set, then we have that this Vinogradov's 3 primes theorem holds for our set. So this sort of answers the question satisfactorily in the sense that it says that the only possible obstruction is really this Bohr set obstruction, but it doesn't tell much about these parameters here. I mean, we just have some k and some eta that k is bounded and eta is 1 over eta is bounded, but it doesn't tell us much. It requires that all the Bohr sets, which are some of them are pretty tiny, if we have a k to be 1,000 and eta to be 1 over 1,000, then this thing is pretty small proportion of numbers. But anyway, if we can show that all Bohr sets contain numbers from B, then we have Vinogradov's 3 primes theorem. And this only holds for subset of primes of lower density, but we can make it work also subset of primes that have a positive density inside a pseudo-random majorant. So it doesn't only work for positive density subset of the primes, but it also works for positive density subsets of subsets of primes that have some sort of sieve upper bound, sieve majorant. And thanks to this, we were able to use this theorem to show that if we take a set of primes to be so-called chain primes, the primes for which p plus 2 has at most 2 prime factors, this set is now not a positive density subset of the primes, but it has positive density inside of it's a sort of a set that you can sieve, and you get the sieve upper bound. And for that sieve upper bound, you can get the pseudo-randomness so that it's enough to have positive density there. So that's why we can apply the theorem here to solve this case of chain primes. And also, we need to figure out that all Bohr sets contain some chain primes. And that goes back to studying some exponential sums. So von Biewer-Vinogradov type results for exponential sums, because we want to sieve the chain primes inside the Bohr set. But I don't go into any details about that. But instead, I will move on to looking more carefully about this problem here, that this is only a qualitative result rather than a quantitative result. And for this, I take another example of primes, which I think it's the most natural subset of the primes you can look at if for whether Vinogradov's theorem holds or not, which is looking at almost equal primes. So what if we take our set P of primes? We saw that they are, from a short interval, they are all close to each other in the sum. So we look at those P's for which the difference from n over 3, we want to represent n as a three sum of three things. So if we want all of them have to be about equal, they all have to be have size n over 3. And if we look at this subset of the primes, it now depends on n, but the dependent is quite mild, so we don't care about it. But anyway, we want to represent n as a sum of three primes where these primes come from a short interval around n over 3. And for this, there is quite a few previous results. And the previous record is due to Baker and Harman, and it's is that if we take theta b equal 4 over 7, then we can represent n as sum of three primes for which all large enough odd n can be represented as a sum of three almost equal primes, where the parameter for the almost equality is 4 over 7. And here we have a theorem, which well, it doesn't quite fit into Bremsen's here, but we can essentially apply this theorem to the problem in hand. If we can show that all the short interval Bohr sets contain a positive proportion of primes, then for some theta, then this theorem would imply that we also get improvement for this Baker-Hellman exponent. And it turns out that that we can do this. So I didn't give any details of the previous application of this theorem, so I will say a bit about how actually we apply this theorem, how we figure out that this sort of condition holds. So apply this theorem I have with Fernando. What we want to do is we need to find some minorand of the primes, so some function which is at most 1 for the primes and at most 0 for the non-primes, such that we understand the created exponential sums. and such that this row has positive density. So if we can understand this sort of exponential sums for all gamma, then we can solve this because we can Fourier expand the definition of the Bohr set. We actually use a smooth version of the Bohr set, and then we can use Fourier expansion to get rid of the summation condition that P belongs to the set B and replace it by a sum of exponential sums. And if we understand all these twists by the exponential sums, then we can actually get a positive density lower bound as long as this minor end here has a positive density. And it was pointed out to us by Kin Hallman that we can, this is actually doable with theta equal to 5 over 9. And 5 over 9 is somewhat smaller than 4 over 7. So, and for a completely different thing, Kin Hallman has actually done this, found this lower bound for which you can understand these things, and he worked it out for the theta equal to 5 over 9. So using this theorem by myself and Fernando, one can improve this 4 over 7 of Beck and Hallman to 5 over 9. But we wanted to do better. Actually, we thought pessimistically that this is not very helpful and this exponent won't be very good, and we were trying to do better than 4 over 7 so by other means, and after we managed to do that, Kalman pointed out that actually his work gives 5 over 9. But luckily our exponent is better than 5 over 9, so it's not a problem. Okay, so then how to get into something better is that we want to understand this quantitatively better, this Bohr set obstruction. So here we wanted to have a lower bound in all Bohr sets, but really the obstruction for the Bohr sets should be troublesome only when the Bohr set has density at, if you are stuck in a Bohr set of density at most 1 over 3, I'm messing that up. So the Bohr set obstruction should be a problem only if you are stuck in a large Bohr set. So the Bohr set obstruction is then a problem if you are stuck in a Bohr set of density at most 1 over 3. If we replace this 1 over 6 minus epsilon here by 1 over 6 plus epsilon, then we replace this minus 3 epsilon by plus 3 epsilon, and then all the integrals are suddenly here. So we only have problems if this thing here is at most 1 over 6. And in particular, we only have problems if we are stuck in a Bohr set of density at most 1 over 3. So the point is that only being sort of trapped in the Bohr set density smaller than 1 over 3 would be a problem. So this approach we were using was taking care of being trapped in a Bohr set of density 1 over million or something like this, and it shouldn't be a problem if of 1 minus 1 over million, but it shouldn't be a problem if everything is in a Bohr set of density 1 minus 1 over million, because we're well enough. If we take a threefold subset of that, we certainly cover everything. So only we should be in trouble if we are trapped in a Bohr set of density smaller than 1 over 3. And being trapped in a Bohr set of density 1 over 3 is the same thing as missing a Bohr set of density at least 2 over 3. So only missing a Bohr set density at least 2 over 3 should be a problem. So here we are worrying about missing Bohr sets of density 1 over 1 million, but that's not a serious issue if you miss such Bohr set. It should be, sort of morally speaking, it should be only a problem if we miss a pretty large Bohr set of density 2 over 3. So Here we are only in trouble if we are trapped in a boset of density smaller than 1 over 3. So it's only a problem if we miss a boset of density 2 over 3, whereas this thing here requests us to have a good bounds for all bosets. And so the question is, how can we solve a better version of this theorem where we only need some bosets where these parameters are much smaller, where we have, well, in particular, the k over eta is at most 2 over 3, no, at least 2 over 3. And unfortunately, we don't quite have that, but we can get a version of this result which is good enough for the application. And let's make first an observation that if we want to avoid missing a boset of density 2 over 3, what does it mean? So if we get B to be a boset of density, and we look at primes in this boset, then we can make a trivial observation, which is that this is the number of all primes in this interval minus the numbers that are not in the boset. So that's obvious. But then the point is that we can give a pretty good lower bound for this. And then the question becomes, can we give a decent upper bound for this? So here we don't have anything about the boset. We only need a lower bound for the number of primes in a short interval. And that can be done pretty well. And the correct shape of the lower bound is the length of the interval divided by log x, which is the probability of a thing being prime. And then there's a lower bound factor alpha minus, which if we had prime number theorem for intervals of length x to theta, it would be 1. But for even theta smaller than 7 over 12, so 7 over 12, we would have prime number theorem in arithmetic progressions. But then we go below that, we still get a lower bound of correct order of magnitude. And the alpha minus gets smaller and smaller, then theta gets smaller and smaller, and eventually at theta being 0.525, this alpha minus is only 0.01 or something like this. And after that, it becomes negative as far as we know. It should be 1 all the way down to theta equal to x to epsilon. But anyway, we do know that there are some lower bounds for this. And then we would like to give an upper bound for this thing here. And let's pretend that we have an upper bound of this, which is of correct order of magnitude, say, alpha plus times x to theta over log x times density B complement. And then the density of B complement, we were assuming that B is a boset of density at least 2 over 3. So this is as density smaller than 1 over 3. And then this thing here is positive. If we have that this alpha plus is smaller than 3 times alpha minus. And so this sort of is related to our intuition that only bosets of, well, so what this suggests is that if we can find this alpha plus and alpha minus such that alpha plus is at most 3 times alpha minus, then we do have ternary Godbach, assuming that this intuition here is correct. And what we can show is that if we can find this alpha plus and alpha minus, then we do have ternary Godbach. But thank you. So if we can solve this lower bound for this and this upper bound for this, and if we have this inequality here, then sort of heuristically speaking, we should be fine because that means that we don't miss any more sets of density. That's the 2 over 3, and we can make this claim rigorous. And in particular, I would like to point out that if we take theta to be 0.55 plus epsilon, which is somewhat better than this 5 over 9, which is 0.5555, I think, so then Becker-Hammann pins have studied primes in short intervals and also with this arithmetic progression thing I'm forgetting about here, and they have shown that one can take alpha minus to be 0.99, which means that the bound for the alpha plus we need is very close to 3. And so we know what to do about this alpha minus, and then for the alpha plus, we want to solve that this as an upper bound like this. So let's write this for star. And studying this star means that we want an upper bound for the number of things in a Borset. I mean, the complement of a Borset is essentially a Borset as well. So this corresponds to looking at the things, upper bound for things in the Borset. And this is similar to what we had previously. Previously, we wanted to have this lower bound for the primes such that we understand these exponential sums. And now we want to have the upper bound for the primes such that we understand the exponential sums. So this corresponds to finding from plus of n, which is a majorant for the characteristic function of the primes, such that we understand the corresponding exponential sum. Again, if we can do this, then by Fourier expanding the definition of the Borset, we get the this thing with the alpha plus. And and the alpha plus that we get for this thing using our understanding of this corresponds to what sort of how good upper bound this rho plus is. It comes from the zeroth Fourier coefficient, so it comes from this term here, and it's the sort of how many times we count the primes, so how bad majorant it is. So it's alpha plus corresponds to this. Ratio of the upper bound compared to the actual thing. And here, similarly, the alpha minus, or this, we wanted to have a positive density lower bound, so we had sort of we wanted a minorant for which the corresponding ratio is positive. And here we want a majorant for which this ratio here, this alpha plus, is essentially smaller than 3. So we have a bit more room to play here with because the sort of the correct thing is 1, and here we want to have at most 3. And here also the correct thing is 1, but we want to have at least 0. So there's 1 of room to sort of be losing by making the minorant. I mean, we can throw away about x over log x things, or 1 minus epsilon x over log x things. But here we are looking for a majorant which has ratio at most 3, or three of us, almost three, which means that we sort of can throw away twice all the primes or something like this. So there's sort of more room to play with here, which makes our task easier. And also in general, finding sort of sieve majorant is somewhat easier than finding sieve minorant. So this task we have here is easier than the using this result and finding this minorant. So that's the reason why we can hope to get into somewhat shorter intervals. But as and one thing is that I haven't sort of told you that rigorously that actually this sort of heuristic that it's enough to look at this four sets of density 2 or 3 is enough. And we actually can't show that it's enough to look at missing four sets of density 2 over 3. But what we can show is that it's enough to have these bounds for the exponential sums, or understand these exponential sums very well, and to have this lower bound. And this information of having this majorant and this Baker-Hamann pinching is then sufficient for getting this intuitive thing. But on the other hand, the intuitive thing doesn't imply this, these things here. So we are sort of having a weaker theorem, but for that we still have this same information is enough, because we don't have know any better way of studying this boset than using this trivial thing here. Anyway, I will now write down the theorem which shows that it's actually enough to have these two pieces of information about this, and these numbers alpha plus and alpha minus, which are nice shape. And this is called the transference principle. And I should say that all this transference principle and all these techniques are going back to the work of Green and also Green Tao on arithmetic progressions in primes. But the thing why this is much more somewhat more difficult doing these Goldbach type things is that they have a don't have a translation invariant equation, and that's why all these posets are causing us trouble and all these arithmetic progressions are causing us trouble. And we have to be careful about that. So whereas when you go look at arithmetic progressions in subset of primes, you can always guarantee that there are some, because you can just stick into a nice boset there, you are stuck, and there are still arithmetic progressions there, but then we have these obstructions about the doing the not translational invariant equation. But some sort of similar techniques are used here. We just need to prove a different type of transference principle, but the things are going back to the Green's original work on the three-term arithmetic Broad's theorem for the three-term arithmetic progressions, but things are a bit different. Okay. Okay. So let's state the transference principle. So I need a couple of parameters. So if I have function f1, f2, f3. So if we have three functions that satisfy certain properties, so the first thing is that they have this, essentially this minorant, this alpha minus, which means that for every AP, density, positive density eta, we have that the sum of FEn So if the F has density at least 1 over 3 in all arithmetic progressions, and we have a majorant. Nu I. Well, it's a majorant, which means that if I is pointwise at most nu I, and such that if we compare the retransform of the majorant with the retransform 1, then the Fourier coefficients are bounded. Yeah. And third thing is that we have that the huge norm of the Fourier transform. That's 1 over Q. Then we have that the convolution of these three functions okay. So these conditions here, the first condition essentially corresponds to having this lower bound, this alpha minus thing here. And the second condition essentially corresponds to understanding, having this majorant rho plus, for which we understand the Fourier expansion or the twist by exponential. So understanding it means that when we correctly normalize everything, understanding means that we have this inequality here. And the third thing is that the Fi have a pseudorandom majorant, which is a work of Green and Tao. And so we don't have to work for this. And essentially, we don't have to work for this because Becker Hamer-Pinch did this already. And so the only thing inside this transference principle that we have to work is this number 2. And also, we have to prove the transference principle. And let me first say, for the application, we morally take this nu to be rho plus over alpha plus. So in particular, remember that rho plus had average alpha plus, so that this have average 1. So for the zeroth Fourier coefficient, things work well. And also, it works for other Fourier coefficients as long as we understand this in a correct way. And morally, we take this Fi to equal characteristic function of the primes over alpha plus. So by this Baker Harman Pinch lower bound, we have the lower bound alpha minus x theta over log x here, which means that this Fi has average at least 1 over 3. And the Baker-Hamer-Pinch thing works also in this dense arithmetic progression. So we still get that this is at least 1 over 3 plus epsilon. I mean, this is alpha minus over alpha plus. But once we have that, this alpha minus. OK, I'm missing the important condition here. OK, alpha minus over alpha plus is at least 1 over 3 plus epsilon. Then we get to apply this theorem. And more we take n to be x2. There are some things to play with, but anyway, we can sort of apply this thing for the theorem we have, assuming that we have these two things, this Baker-Hamer-Pinch thing, which we have, and we have this majorant that we understand the twists, and we can construct such majorant using just the work of Baker and Harman on this problem. I mean, they are constructing a minorant and a majorant, and the point of our work is that it's actually enough to have a majorant which has good for real properties. And for the minor rand, it's enough that we just know it for the primes and we don't have any twists there. So that's sort of what gives us advantage over the work of Baker and Harman. So I don't say anything more about how to get from this transference principle to the theorem. You just have to figure out this measurement, and it's technically annoying, but it's sort of well known how to do it. But let me say a few words about how to prove this transference principle here. So the first thing is to use the transference technique of Green and Tao, which allows us to reduce it to the case there. We don't just have a general measurand, but the measurand function is essentially identity. And the case, let me state the case nu equals to 1, which is that if we have epsilon, then there exists eta, such that if fi, 0, 1, so measurand is now the identity function 1, so our functions are from 0 to 1 now, such that for every AP we have and because we have a simple measurement, we don't have to care about the other conditions anymore, but we just have then that then conclusion that then for each n okay, so this looks more trackable than the previous one, and it's thanks to this transference technique of Green and Tao that they can do this. And how to reduce from this thing into this thing where we have this simple measurement. So we reduction is true writing this FA as gi plus fi minus gi, and this gi is defined to be the average of f on over the Bosets. The Boset is defined. So we write it in this way, and this b here of those in a certain set, and this set D is a spectrum of the function f. This is a similar that what happens when you look at the three-term arithmetic progressions and Roth's theorem for them. So you approximate this fi by gi, which is the average of f by a well-chosen over well-chosen Bosets, and then you can show that this gi satisfies the properties we need here of this, and you can apply gi for this, and then this case nu equals to 1 for this gi, and these things here contribute a smaller error term thanks to the definition of the of the functions Ti according to the Bohr sets there. We have the spectrum here, but I don't go into any of the details here. But anyway, you can reduce from this general transference principle to this case where you have nu equals to 1. And then I will say a few words about the proof of this last game, which is still remaining for the complete proof. So this starts to look pretty elementary already. We just have essentially, we can think of f as a set rather than a function taking values 0 to 1. And then we are saying that if we have a set which has density at least 1 over 3 in every arithmetic progression, then everything can be represented as a sum of three things from this set. So the first thing is that here we have a lower bound for logarithmic progressions, but by just making f somewhat smaller, we can just assume that we have essentially a similar sort of upper bound here, that f, the average of f over all the arithmetic progressions is essentially 1 over 3 rather than being at least 1 over 3. So we can decrease I to assume that the most so just splitting into some arithmetic progressions, we can do this sort of reduction. And this allows us to use things that we know about four doubling. So there are some partial results about sets with four doubling. So now we can use lemma, which is due to Green. This lemma says that if we have a subset of the integers such that if we look at A plus A, it has size at most 4 times A minus epsilon times N, then there is an arithmetic progression which has density at least eta, such that this A has more than half of the elements in the arithmetic progression, so that this intersection of A with B has size at least half minus epsilon. Okay, so it's a partial result toward knowing what happens for the set of with doubling at most 4. And it says that if we have doubling at most 4, A plus A has size at most 4 times A, then there must be some arithmetic progression which has a positive density, such that this set A has almost half of the elements of the arithmetic progression. But well, we can think of this Fi to be a characteristic function of something, and we surely know that it doesn't have almost half of the elements in some arithmetic progression because it has density 1 over 3 in all arithmetic progressions. So this characteristic function must have doubling at least 4, which means that if we have a density 1 over 3 for the Fi, then if we look at Fi convolved with Fi, we get density larger than 2 over 3, and then we have a set of density larger than 2 over 3, and we have another set of density larger than 1 over 3, so there must be some intersection going on, and that means that we can actually get this result for the convolution. I don't give the details, but it's a sort of pigeonholing after you apply this. But anyway, I think it's good time to finish here. Thanks.
Any questions for Kaiser?
What's the final value of theta that you get?
So it's 0.55.
And is it effective, the BU sequence theorem? Do you have an effective chance to n naught at the end of the day?
So I think we have effective because we only use progressions modulo or something fixed.
Number three on the board that's just behind you. Do you really need the kind of mean value Fourier estimate for all q in that range, or just some q less than three?
It's enough to have some q. Yeah.
Okay. What if there are no more questions? Let's thank Kaiser again.